We did get involved. What was it, Bob? The Winter of Frankie Machine?
Yeah.
For the project?
Yeah. Yeah. And
I mean, well, we weren't too enthusiastic about it, sorry. But we decided we had to do something. Eric gave you a book called I Heard You Paint Houses by Charles Brandt for research.
Yeah, I mean, we were talking about it. He said he just read it, and it just come out. And I said, oh, I got to read that book. And then when Marty and I were preparing, so that was about 2 years earlier than when Marty and I were starting to, were committed to Frankie Machine, and Marty was starting to show me films like Jean Gabin
film like Touche par Grisby and Melville's Dulot and Le Deuxième Souffle and pictures like that.
Then I said, well, I have to read this book that I've been always wanting to read called I Heard You Paint Houses. And so I did read it just as research for the character. And then after I read it, I got together with Marty and I said, you got to look at this because I think this is what you're going to want to do. So that was it. Steve wrote the script, which was terrific, wonderful, as Marty says. And then it was a matter of getting everybody's schedules to line up. And Marty was doing Hugo. I remember coming over here. I don't know when you were doing Hugo.
2009, 2010, I think, yeah.
And we were talking about that and how to what we were going to do and his availability. And he wanted to do Silence and so on. And then I had said to Marty I wanted to make sure he was okay if we would just let it out there when we talk on interviews. And usually I'm very superstitious about that because when you talk about it, it usually doesn't happen. But I thought maybe in this case, since we were we had no backers, no people really interested, the idea that we were doing it with Al and Joe, that I cleared it with Marty, and then I talked to Joe and then Al about they're okay, and he mentioning that they're on board. So we did that, and then we had a reading of the script. I don't know what year that was.
The reading of the script was right before the January, right before you left to go do Silence. We had this one opportunity to get everyone together, and we taped a reading.
2012.
It was a movie that evolved. It would have. Could it have been done earlier? Yes, but the story came out at a certain point. The book came out. That took so many years to evolve. We actually had problems getting the rights to the story. There was a lot of confusion there too. That took a bit of time. And everything, and when you always see these movies, that especially in the old days, they'd have 15 years in the making, finally on the screen. This is what it's all about.
It's
That's
really
what
scheduling
it is.
Scheduling and legal and
everything. Yeah. Legal, schedule, actors, availability, director, everybody, the whole thing. It's, but we're just happy that we were able to make it. And I had a great time. I would have shot for another 5-6 months with Marty.
Yeah.
What did it feel like looking at yourselves younger for the first time when you were looking back at the movie? Was it a bit crazy?
That's on you guys, not on me.
I always joke that my career will be extended another 30 years. No, it's a whole interesting thing because where it will evolve. As far as I was just thinking about copyrights and later and you and likeness and this and who gets it after we're all long gone, families and stuff like that. I mean, they even have that now in some ways with using famous actors from years ago in commercials who have create a certain whatever that they represent what that product is, whatever. Mm-hmm. So all that stuff. I don't know. I'm just happy we're at the beginning stages of it really being explored and goes. God knows where it'll go.
Yeah.
And what excited me about it was that Pablo Hellman was doing this thing and wanted to make it state of the art, the best it could be to date, and that was an ambition for this movie, which was ambitious always, all the time. It fit the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and certain things with like Marty, we would, every so often I would come in to narrate pieces that Marty was figured that we had to sort of
what do you call it? Voiceover.
Voiceover to give information or whatever, or sort of tighten
something, yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
And that's a normal part of making a movie. And this, you know.
Yeah, you even went into the audio tracks, the tracks of Frank Sheeran's actual voice,
yes,
stories, and every now and then we go and we pick you.
Yeah, yeah.
Tell me something. I said, oh yeah, it's interesting, yeah, yeah. And we'd fool around with that and try, yeah, to find time to shoot it in the film. I'd give it to Emma and tell her, could you find some production time, please?
I'd say yes.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this was a simple story. It was about, yeah, a guy who was caught between two people who were powerful people, and one of them was disappeared. We never knew what happened to him, really, to this day. The other one was also the Joe Gallo, referring to, right, him. You still don't know who did that to him. It had that to hang on in some ways, this political, this sort of, this grand story with these historical, if you want, type characters, and a simple story.
Yeah. And also, Bob, in terms of that, when you're talking about these guys, and then on the other level, you have JFK, Bobby Kennedy, Martin Luther King, you've got, yeah, all this going on, and nobody knows really what happened there. And I always say, but would it make any difference now if we knew exactly who, when, how, and where? No. It's the dark forces that take over. They just walk by the TV and there's missiles coming from Cuba, you know. So, and that's your afternoon lunch, you know. So, that when you say the simple story, that was the thing to hold on to, the simplicity of it, because the rest is so complicated.